In this tutorial, we will build a dynamic setup that bumps up the details when moving very close to our shaders. For this, we will use the camera distance to seamlessly blend between different texture maps in order to work texture resolution independent. So here I prepared a little demo scene to demonstrate a problem that oftentimes occurs. We specifically talk about this aluminium frame in here. You can see from this distance here, it actually looks quite nice. We have these subtle imperfections, this rough surface. But the problem is it only works from a certain distance, because once I zoom in closer, you can clearly see the texture map that I use in here, and it's starting to fall apart. So it basically only works from a certain distance, and whenever you go in close, it's not gonna work anymore. So in this video, I want to show you a solution that I came up with in order to eliminate this problem. So now I applied a different shader that uses exactly the same texture map. So you can see we have exactly the same result from this distance in here. However, the difference is that it uses a slightly different setup. And now you can see this holds up much nicer if we go close. I can go actually really, really close. You can see we have all of these kind of like small micro details in here that have the correct scaling in terms of size in here. And still, if we zoom back, we have this kind of like flaky appearance. And I said this is done through a slightly different approach, which I'm gonna introduce you now. So the way to achieve this is by blending different scaled textures depending on the distance to the camera. And I pre-visualize this here with these simple color tones. So in this distance, we will have this kind of like red texture map, let's say. And then once we zoom in closer, you can see this will fade over to this kind of like greenish texture map. This has a different scaling then. And then once we go even closer, it will fade over to this bluish texture map, which will be even more small in scale. And then once we go in even closer, then this is fading to here, this kind of like yellow texture map. So it's basically blending between three or four different texture maps here. And they always make sure that the scaling of the texture here looks correct from the current distance of the camera. And this is basically how this whole workflow here will work. You can see you can zoom in and out, and it's kind of like really blending nicely between those different texture maps in here. So this will be the shader that we're building, and you might think it looks a little bit complex, but it's actually fairly simple because there's lots of repeating elements in here. Let me just enable here this pre-visualization with the different colors, and you can see now we have this red shader here shown, or the red texture, which will be this texture in here. And once we go in a little bit closer, you can see it's fading over to this greenish part in here. And then once we're even closer, it's fading over to this bluish part. And then once we're even closer, it's fading over to this yellow part in here. And it's doing this all quite seamless, as you can see. So you can go fairly close and also far away, and it's seamlessly blending through the different texture maps in here then. Let me just disable here the pre-visualization with the different colors and then see how this looks in reality. So you can see we have this nice flaky appearance. And once we go closer here, the scale of these flakes here will adapt so that they look fitting to the camera angle. They don't really look too big, and you can go quite close and you can see very, very detailed flakes in here then. So now let's start to build this here from scratch and see how the whole process here works. So this one right here would be our starting point. You can see we have a simple principled BSDF prepared already. Metallic all the way to 1 and a little bit of roughness. That's pretty much it. And I prepared here a bump node already, which I'm going to be used in order to just pipe in here this flake texture map, which I prepared. And by the way, those texture maps you can always find on my Patreon together with all of my scene files if you're interested in that. So let's connect the flakes here into the height of our bump slot. You can see something is happening already. This looks also cool, but it's not really what we want. And the problem is that we don't really have some UVs here for this model. So with the Node Wrangler add-on enabled, you can just press Ctrl T. It will just build you this basic texture map projection setup. And instead of using the UV coordinates, let's just use the object coordinates. Once we do this, you can see something is happening already, but it's not really showing correctly, probably because the scaling is not correct. So let's just increase the scaling here. You can see something is happening, but it's stretching all the way across the model in here. And instead of using this flat projection mode, let's just use this box projection. Once we do this, it's projecting it from both angles. And let's zoom in a little bit closer. You can see there is this kind of like harsh line where the projection from this side and that side here meet. So in order to get rid of this, we can just play with this blend value in here. So once we increase this, for example, to 0.1, you can see that this kind of harsh line here basically completely disappeared. You can even use higher values. You can see it's then blending here slightly differently. But in our case, we just use some minimal blending of 0.1. That basically just gets rid of this entire problem in here. So the scaling right now, of course, is way too big, but I will leave this on purpose, this size, so it's easy in the tutorial to basically see exactly when the transition is happening. So let's just make here a second setup. So let's just duplicate all of those nodes in here and let's connect this in the bump map slot. You can see it looks identical, of course, but now let's, for example, change the scaling. You can see that now we have a much smaller scale. So we have this texture here that has a bigger scale, and then this texture that has a much smaller scale. So now we could just add a simple mix color. And we can connect both of those shaders into the mix color. And if we connect the result into our height with the factor, now we can blend between those two different textures. So if the factor here is all the way to 0, we will use this one in here. And if it's all the way to 1, then we will use the lower texture in here. So now we just need to make sure that we can define the factor here based on the distance towards the camera. So now I want to make this a bit more obvious. And for this, let's just introduce two simple mix colors in here. So let's add the first one for our bigger scale shader in here. Let's give this a reddish color tone. Let's switch this one here to color. So we're not changing the brightness values. We're just tinting everything here with this color value. And now if I just do the same thing for the other shader in here, so I will give this one here a greenish color tone. And now we can switch between those two different colors in here. If I pre-visualize this node in here, you can see I can switch between red and green, as you can see. And like this, we have it quite easy to see at what point we're using this shader. If we want to, we can also see that in the shaded view. For this, let's also add a mix color in here. And let's just put the base color in the A slot. And let's put this one here into the B slot. And let's put also this one to color mode. And then use this for the base color. And now you can see that we have this kind of reddish tinting that's happening once the bigger scale shader here is applied. Once the smaller scale shader is applied, we have this kind of like greenish tint. And this will make it quite easy for us to understand at what point the transition will happen. So now we need to blend this based on our camera distance. And for this, we can use the camera data node because this has access here to the view distance. And if I just pre-visualize this, you can see now I'm looking at the view distance. If I zoom in and out, you can see that we have this kind of like value which is changing. So the closer I get, the darker it gets. And the further away I get, the brighter it is. But I need to control it and define the range here by myself. And for this, I will use a map range node. Let me just connect this inside here. And then we can play with these values. So we can use, for example, the to max value here of 35, for example. You can see it's all the way bright here. And now if I zoom in, it will slowly get darker. If I want to have this happening earlier, so if I want to have a stronger blend here so that we have it much darker here already, we can increase the from min value. So let's put 0.01, for example. And then you can see we have a much faster blend that's happening here. So we have it all the way white here. And then it's kind of quite easily transitioning into the other part. As you can see, if I want to have this a little bit more subtle, I can make, for example, 0.75. And then the transition will happen a little bit less. So now we have here this map range that defines our blending. And now we can just pipe this into our factor and then see what's happening. So I think at the moment we have those two nodes here flipped. So let's put the B to the A and the A to the B, so that from this distance in here, we have our reddish texture, so the bigger scale texture. Then once we go closer, you can see we have this greenish texture now happening. And that's exactly the whole magic, how you can transition between those two different texture maps here based on the distance. So now that you understood the basic workflow, it's basically just repetitions and deciding how many layers you want to blend. So just now we had only two different layers. We had the red layer and the green layer. But in this example here, I have two more layers. I have a blue layer and I have a yellow layer. You can see the only thing that changes is basically this color and then also the scale value. So this one has a scaling of 75, this one a scaling of 100, 400 and 500 to have my different layers. And then instead of having just one map range node, I have three map range nodes to basically blend between the different states. And the only thing that changes here is the two max values. So the first blend will happen at 35. So that's the transition between the red and the green. The next transition will happen at 70. That's the transition between green and blue. And then the last transition will happen at 250. And that's the transition then between blue and yellow. And instead of just using one color mix node for blending two layers, I basically have to daisy chain then the next layers in additional color mix nodes, which then all are driven by the respective map range node here that goes into the factor of the different nodes in here. The setup is basically quite logical and should be easy to understand because it's just repeating the steps that we did already earlier for those first two layers. The only thing that differs is that I just put this value slide in here, which just drives all of the different factors and also drives here my pre-visualization at the end. And like this, I can just easily switch on and off all of the different pre-visualizations, and we can see nicely our shader if I have this set to 0. And if I have it at 1, I can see exactly at what point the blends here are happening. So now as the very, very last step, I want to bring in some additional procedural noise that basically just kicks in when we're extremely close here to our surface, so I don't have to bring in another additional layer. And this I prepared down here. You can see it's just a simple noise texture with some mapping coordinates. We use the object coordinates here again. And I have the scale value here quite high so that we get very, very small noise. So let's now pipe that into our setup. And the way we can do that is to just basically connect here the normal output of this bump node into the second bump node, and then just connect this one into the principal BSDF normal input. You can see at the moment nothing is happening because the strength here is set to 0. So I will increase the strength to maybe a value of 3. You can see once I do this, we have this additional detail that happens in here. But the important thing is that the distance value here is set extremely low, because otherwise it will mess up the appearance from this distance in here. You can see now if I put this one here to 0, there's basically no change because the distance value here is so low. So that's why I can use a quite high strength in here. And then this only shows, not even here in this distance, you can see if I have this here all the way to 0, we basically get exactly the same appearance. It only kicks in at the very, very last bit here to just help to blend the texture map here better, that we don't really can see the pixel values in here. So this is basically the last step here of the puzzle. And like this, we then finally can achieve our final shading setup. So I hope this was useful for you. You can use this technique quite frequently for a lot of different situations. And I really like to do that because it allows me to really control exactly how my blends here are happening. And I can make sure that my shader looks correct and nice from all different distances in here. So if you like this kind of content, make sure to subscribe to this channel, because in the future there will be a lot more Blender content coming. And you can also check out my Patreon, because this has a lot of additional goodies and also all of my scene files that you can find in there. So check that out if that's interesting for you. Otherwise, see you next tutorial. Take care and see you soon.